In the last lecture, we talked of units, particularly the SI system of units. In this one, we take up dimensions of physical quantities, and we shall also do something about dimensional analysis. You must be thinking that these are very simple concepts. They may be simple, but they are of great importance in physics. In dimensional analysis, we will talk of dimensions of various quantities, how we deal with them and how we use them to get something that we don't know. You know, most physical quantities you would come across in physics can be expressed in combinations of 5 basic dimensions. What are these dimensions? Mass, denoted by capital M, length, denoted by capital L, time, denoted by capital T, electrical current, denoted by capital I, and temperature, denoted by the Greek letter theta. Since all quantities in mechanics can be expressed in terms of mass, length, and time, for the present, we deal only with these dimensions. And here is a word of caution. Remember that dimensions are not the same thing as units. For example, speed can be measured in units of meter per second or kilometer per hour, but its dimensions are always length divided by time, or simply L T to the power minus 1. The following examples show how dimensions of physical quantities are combinations of powers of M, L, and T. Volume, for example, is the cube of a certain length. So, its dimensions are L to the power 3. Density is mass divided by volume. Therefore, its dimensions are M, L to the power minus 3. Velocity is length divided by time. Its dimensions, therefore, are L T to the power minus 1. Acceleration is velocity per unit time, or change of velocity per unit time. So, therefore, its dimensions are length per unit time, that is L T to the power minus 2. Force is mass multiplied by acceleration. Its dimensions are therefore M L T to the power minus 2. So, what is dimensional analysis? Dimensional analysis is the process of deriving unknown relations when we know the physical quantities they depend upon, and secondly, checking the dimensions of a quantity or a combination of quantities. One of the important principles of dimensional analysis is that each term on two sides of an equation must have the same dimensions. Dimensional analysis helps us in checking the accuracy of equations, getting the dimensions of a quantity using an equation. The following examples illustrate the use of dimensional analysis. You already know that the mechanical energy of a particle of mass m can be written in two different ways. One is half m v squared, and the other is m g h, where m is the mass of the particle, v is its velocity, g is the acceleration due to gravity, and h is the height of the particle from the Earth's surface. Since the two expressions represent the same quantity, namely energy, their dimensions must be the same. We prove this by actually writing the dimensions of the two expressions. The dimension of m is capital M, and the dimension of velocity is a length divided by time, or L T to the power minus 1. The acceleration being velocity divided by time, its dimensions are L T to the power minus 2. Since acceleration due to gravity is an acceleration, its dimensions are also L T to the power minus 2. The height being a distance or length its dimension is L. So, let us write down dimensions of half mv squared are m L t minus 1 to the power 2 or m L square t to the power minus 2. Dimensions of m g h are m L t to the power minus 2 into L or again m L square t minus 2. You can see that both are obviously the same, because they we are dealing with the same quantity, namely energy. In fact, once we have the dimensions of a quantity like energy, we can apply them anywhere, whether the energy is heat energy, electrical energy, chemical energy, nuclear energy, atomic energy, whatever the nature of energy, its dimensions will always be the same as we have derived earlier. Let us take an example. The energy of a photon is equal to h times nu, where h is constant and nu is the frequency of the photon. Dimensions of energy being known, we have just derived them, m L square t minus 2, that of the frequency being 1 by t or t to the power minus 1, the dimensions of Planck constant are easy to find. We write dimensions of h equal to m L square t minus 2 divided by t raised to power minus 1, which gives us m L square t to the power minus 1. So, the dimensions of h we have found very easily, they are m L square t to the power minus 1. Note that numerical factors like half in the expression for kinetic energy have no dimensions. Besides numerical factors, other quantities which do not have dimensions are angles and arguments of trigonometric, like a sine, cosine, etcetera, exponential and logarithms. In sine x, for example, x is said to be the argument of the sine function and it has no dimensions. In fact, it should not have any dimensions. In e to the power x, x is said to be the argument of the exponential function and it must not have any dimensions. That the argument of a trigonometric function must be dimensionless is a very useful information, because if it is found that the argument of a trigonometric function in any formula or expression derived by us is not dimensionless, then one can safely assume that we have made a mistake somewhere or that something is wrong. Again, let us take an example. Use the dimensional analysis by illustrating with an example. Experience tells us that the distance covered by a car, say S, starting from rest and having uniform acceleration depends on time and acceleration. Let us use the dimensional analysis to find expression for the distance covered. Solution: suppose the distance covered S depends on the mth power of t and nth power of a. Then we may write S proportional to t to the power m into a to the power n, expressing the two sides. Now, in terms of dimensions, we get L to the power 1, t to the power 0, m to the power 0 is proportional to t to the power m into L t minus 2 whole to the power n, or L to the power 1, t to the power 0, m to the power 0 is proportional to t to the power m minus 2 n into L to the power n. Now, we compare the powers on the two sides of the equation and we get easily that n must be equal to 1 and m must be equal to 2. So, we have S proportional to a t square. This is important. This is as far as we can go with dimensional analysis. Dimensional analysis does not help us in getting the numerical factors since they have no dimensions. To get the numerical factors, we must get input either from experiment or from theory. We have already learnt that the arguments of trigonometric and exponential functions must be dimensionless. Let me give you an example. In radioactive decay, for example, you write the equation n after time t is equal to n 0, where n 0 is the initial number, e to the power minus lambda times t. Now, the argument of the exponential function must have no dimensions. That means lambda times t must be dimensionless, which means that the decay constant lambda must have the dimensions of 1 by t. That means it must be expressed in second inverse or seconds to the power minus 1. This is a familiar equation to you, the wave equation. You will learn it and you will deal with it for a long time. The equation is written as y equal to a sine kx minus omega t. Now, each term in the argument of the sine function must be dimensionless. So, k must have dimensions of inverse length and omega must have dimensions of inverse time. And therefore, you realize that k is equal to 2 pi by lambda and omega is 2 pi times nu. In Bernoulli theorem, you are familiar with this theorem, I'm sure, half v squared plus g z plus p by rho is constant. And we said earlier that each term of the equation must have the same dimensions. Here also, each term is energy per unit mass. You can check it. You can check that the last term on the left hand side is energy per unit mass. As an example of arriving at an expression, let us find the velocity v of waves on a string. We know that the velocity could depend on the mass m of the string, the length l of the string, and the tension t applied to the string. So, we write v is equal to some constant k, m to the power alpha, l to the power beta, and t to the power gamma, where k is a numerical constant having no dimensions. And remember, this is a general method of using dimensional considerations to derive an expression of a quantity where we know its dependence on other quantities. We now write the equation in terms of dimensions. On the left hand side, you have l t to the power minus 1. On the right hand side, you have k m to the power alpha, l to the power beta, and m l t minus 2 whole to the power gamma. So, we collect these indices alpha, beta, gamma and compare the powers on the two sides of the equation. And we get easily alpha equal to minus half, beta equal to half and gamma equal to half. Once we know that, we can write velocity equal to k times l t by m under root. Now, k is a constant and we cannot find out its value. This must come from some experiment. So far, we have learnt the importance of dimensions and dimensional analysis. Let us see how dimensional analysis can help you in getting answers to questions. This question I have taken from the medical entrance examination conducted by the CBSC. Power dissipated in an LCR circuit connected to an AC source of EMF E is, and there are four options. And the solution is easy. You know that power has dimensions E squared by R. On this basis alone, options 1, 3 and 4 can be discarded, giving option 2 as the correct response. You can verify that option 1 has dimensions simply E squared. Dimension option 3 has again dimensions of E squared, and 4 has dimensions of E squared times R. All wrong. Only 2 is the correct option. In the next lecture of this series, we shall deal with errors in measurement.